I don't like to work with patients who are in love. Love and psychotherapy are fundamentally incompatible. A good therapist tries to conquer darkness and seek illumination, while romantic love is sustained by mystery and crumbles if you look at it too closely. I hate to be love's executioner. And yet, in the opening minutes of my first meeting with Thelma, when she told me that she was completely, hopelessly, and tragically in love, I never hesitated to accept her for treatment. Not for one moment. I thought I could help her. But right from the start, I could see that it wasn't going to be easy.
Now you say you're lonely. You cry the long night through. Well, you can cry me a river. Cry me a river. I cried a river over you.
So you want to know about me? Well, you ask for it. My life is hell, okay? Hell. 8 years ago, I had a love affair with a man called Matthew. Since then, he has never left my mind. I was 62. He was 36. For 27 days, we were lovers.
You haven't seen Matthew since?
He won't see me. He won't even call me. I still love him. Everything about him. His voice, his hands, his smile. I'm in love with a man I haven't even seen for 8 years.
As I looked at the shabby woman sitting opposite me with her wrinkled face, peroxide hair, blue-veined hands, and shapeless polyester tracksuit, I tried to maintain an objective expression, but she must have noticed some evidence of disbelief.
Go on, laugh, why don't you?
Why would I do that?
Because you're looking at me and you're thinking to yourself, love? Is she crazy? How can she be in love? The guy must have been desperate. She's a corpse. All I want is to lie in his bed and shut the world outside. He had so much caring, so much loving. Well, maybe these will help persuade you.
She reached into a faded drawstring purse and handed me two old photographs. The first was of a beautiful young woman, wearing a sleek black leotard, and I was startled to meet Thelma's large green eyes peering out at me across the decades.
Yes, that's me, in my dancing days. Oh, I didn't have any problem holding on to lovers then. Until I met Harry, I lived for love. Look at those legs, and my dark, dark hair. Harry said my hair was like silk. He looked at me as if I was so precious I might break.
And Harry is?
My husband. He doesn't look at me like that anymore. He doesn't look at me. Full stop. And this one. This one is me about 8 years ago. Not bad, huh? I mean, you could look at that face, that body, and not really know how old I was. As you can see, I no longer bother with how I look. Nice view you've got from here. Nice to look at the water. All the other times I'd look out of the window and all I could see was concrete and tarmac. Now that was depressing. Before I even started talking, it was depressing.
The other times?
Oh, I've been in therapy for years. It costs a lot of money, so I've always seen students in the past. Now this time, I thought I'd go for the real thing. before I give up and quit altogether. You're supposed to be the best. I read about you. You give lectures, you write books.
Mm-hmm. Have you read them?
No.
Thelma, are you going to take off your coat? You look as if you're not intending to stop.
Well, maybe I won't.
Why don't you tell me some more about Matthew?
Oh, I'd known Matthew for quite a long time.
And suddenly Thelma was smiling again.
From a distance, you might say.
Animated.
Then one day...
Passionate.
Harry was out of town. He's always out of town. He was in the army until he retired, and now he's got time on his hands. He gives talks all over the place for the Boy Scouts. Anyway, it's this beautiful Saturday afternoon, and I'm just out walking, wandering. I was in Union Square, and then suddenly, there he was. Like magic.
Thelma?
Matthew!
I nearly didn't recognize you there. How are you?
Oh, I'm fine. I'm great.
Good.
Oh, it's really good to see you. You look a little pale. Are you okay?
No, I'm fine. Good, really, I'm fine. I've not been well, but... No, but I'm fine now, really. You look great. That color really suits you. It matches your eyes.
Thanks. Harry always likes me in this dress. So, what was wrong with you?
Oh, nothing.
Have you been ill?
No, nothing. Nothing, really. How is Harry?
Out of town.
Nothing's changed there, then, I see.
Oh, you know my life so well. I miss that.
Yeah. Look, you know, it's so crowded here. Would you like to go somewhere? Somewhere quiet? We could catch up? How about it?
Well, I can't think of anything I would rather do.
Well, here. Take my arm. So, how is it?
And then what happened?
Well, there was so much to talk about. I don't know. It was just easy. As if we'd always been like this. And before you know it, it was time for dinner. And one of us says, I can't remember who, why don't we go get something to eat? So we wander over to Skoma's on Fisherman's Wharf, and we order crab chalpino. And we're talking and talking and laughing. And I notice his collars got tucked somehow the wrong way round. And I don't know, it just seems right for me to reach my hand towards him. And he was trembling. Oh, your collar, it's twisted.
Oh.
Here, let me. There. That's better.
Where would I be without you, Thelma? You know, I've got a new apartment in the Haight.
Oh?
Yeah.
I'd love to see your place.
Would you?
Oh, yes.
Well, let's go there then.
And it seems right that night, as we walk away, to touch fingers, then hands, skin on skin. And Harry's away, and it seemed like we'd slipped outside the everyday world. We didn't notice the time. We silently colluded in pretending that nothing unusual was happening. I don't remember much about the rest of the evening after that. I mean, about how things happened. About who touched who first. How we decided to go to bed. We didn't make any decisions. Everything just happened effortlessly and spontaneously. His skin felt so smooth, so young. What I do remember is that lying in Matthew's arms was transporting. One of the greatest moments of my life.
Ah, the apple trees, blossoms in the breeze, that we walked among.
I wish I could stay in this moment forever.
Is that how you feel, Thelma? I mean, it doesn't matter that we didn't, that I didn't...
Matthew, look at me. Do I look like it matters? Tell me I'm beautiful.
You're beautiful.
Tell me you want me.
I want you, Thelma.
I love you, Matthew.
Sunlit. I love you too, Thelma.
Where the hand. Then everything is okay.
On our backs we lie, gazing at the sky. Till the rounds were sung, only last July, when the world was young.
So, you and Matthew made love.
This is what really gets me about therapy. You think everything's about sex. Well, there was no need for sex. I mean, it didn't happen for Matthew. It didn't matter.
You mean he couldn't?
I told you it wasn't about that. It was about us. We touched one another. We agreed that we didn't need sex. We were in love.
So, what happened next?
The next 27 days were magical. We spoke on the phone several times a day. We'd meet for coffee, for dinner. I'd go back to his apartment. Matthew is such a good person. You know, he can't help it. He's always asking people how they are, what they think. He just has this way of making people happy. Being with Matthew was like being a new me. I floated. I glided. I danced. Those 27 days were the peak of my life. I have never been so happy. Not before or since. The last time I saw him was at 12:30 p.m. on July 17th. For 2 days, I'd tried to reach him on the phone, but the answering machine was always on in his apartment, and his secretary said he was in a meeting. So I thought I'd go and find him at his office. Why shouldn't I, after all? I'm his lover. When I walked in, Matthew was eating a sandwich. But when he sees me standing there in front of him, he stops, like I've caught him out.
Thelma.
I was just passing. Don't look so surprised. I thought I'd, you know, pop by, say hello. It's a beautiful day. We should be out taking a walk.
It's great to see you, Thelma, but I have a,
a meeting in 5 minutes. This is not a good time right now.
You know, I think you should get rid of your secretary. I rang and rang. I told her my name and my number. But you haven't called. So it must be that she's keeping back my messages. I mean, I was worried, Matthew. I haven't heard from you for 2 days. I was worried about you. I love you.
I'm fine. You really shouldn't worry. There's no need.
Well, I'm glad.
Thelma, I must get going or I'll be late.
We held hands, didn't we? You and me, in the middle of the crowd. As if we were the only thing in the world.
I know, but Thelma, I don't have time. People are watching.
I think you're overworked, Matthew. Look, I'll call you tomorrow. Maybe we can go for a walk. Or coffee.
Once upon a summertime, if you recall, we stopped beside a little flower stall. A bunch of bright forget-me-nots was all I'd let you buy me.
Here.
Thanks. That was the last time I saw him. After that day, I called him. At first, he returned some of my calls. And when I spoke to him, I felt better for a while. Then the feeling would drain away. So I'd have to call him again, leave another message, sit the day out waiting by the phone. If it rang, my heart would be beating so fast I could hardly get my words out. Then if it wasn't him, if it was some friend of Harry's wanting to talk about a Boy Scout meeting, I'd just fade.
Mad about the boy. It's pretty funny, but I'm mad about the boy.
Don't worry, Harry, I'll get it.
He has a gay appeal that makes me feel there may be something sad about the boy.
Hello?
Thelma.
Matthew. Oh, thank heavens it's you. My darling.
Thelma, please. Look, I'm calling you because I'm really sorry.
What is it, darling? Are you unwell?
No, Thelma, I'm fine. I'm calling because I just think we have to return to our real lives. It's not fair to Harry.
Harry doesn't know a thing. He probably wouldn't care if he did. It's okay, darling.
No, it isn't. It's not okay for me. Look, I've met someone else. Did you hear me, Thelma?
I don't understand.
What we had was not real.
Are you in love?
Oh, please, Thelma.
I have the right to ask you a question. Are you in love?
I don't know. It's too soon. Thelma, this is really difficult. Like I said, I mean, look, we have other lives. You're married. And look at me. I'm breaking every code in the book.
Am I so easily forgotten?
Oh, God, Thelma.
Is she good looking? Good company? Is she young? Oh, she's got to be younger than me, of course. That would go without saying.
Have you slept with her? Have you done it with her?
Stop this.
Or do I mean him? I mean, come on, let's not kid ourselves, Matthew.
Thelma, that's enough.
Matthew, you can't go. You can't just... Matthew.
Mad about the boy. It's pretty funny, but I'm mad about the boy. He has a gay appeal that makes me feel there may be something sad about the boy.
He cut me off. I stopped hearing from him altogether. Complete silence.
Do you know why?
If only I did. I never could find out why. And for 8 years, I haven't stopped thinking about him. Not an hour goes by without me having some fantasy about him. I stay at home all day, just staring out of the window. I don't sleep. At 7 a.m, I wonder if he's awake yet. At 8, I imagine him eating his oatmeal. He loves oatmeal. I keep looking for him when I walk down the street. I often think I see him and rush up to greet some stranger. I dream about him. Most of my life goes on in these daydreams. Harry watched me go steadily downhill for 6 months and tried to persuade me to see a doctor.
And did you?
I saw 3. I told each of them I wasn't sleeping, so they gave me tablets, all 3 of them. Lots of tablets. Harry went out of town for a week. When he'd gone, I took the phone off the hook, swallowed all the pills, and went to bed.
Hmm. So, how come you're sitting in front of me?
Well, Harry couldn't sleep that night. Maybe he sensed something. He kept trying to phone me. When he can't get through, he begins to worry. In the end, he calls the neighbors, who bang on the door, and when they can't get an answer, they call the police. It took a lot of medical effort to bring me back.
Well, tell me about the therapy you've had in that time, since your suicide attempt.
I suppose I didn't give it much of a chance, really. I decided I wouldn't ever mention Matthew. You're the first person I've told.
Wait a minute. You mean to say that in 8 years of therapy, you have never talked about Matthew? But today you've made a decision to tell me. To be honest about yourself.
I'm here to make one final attempt to find a way to live with some iota of happiness. You're my last chance.
Walking down the street, his eyes look out at me from people that I meet. I can't believe it's true, but when I'm blue in some strange way, I'm glad about the boy.
You see why it's a bad idea to work with people who are in love? My first session with Thelma had given me a lot to think about. First, there was Matthew, who presented something of an enigma. What drives an attractive, presumably accomplished young man in his early 30s to choose a 62-year-old woman as his lover? As for Thelma, the most striking thing about her was the depth of her suffering, the tenacity of her love, a love which had possessed her for 8 years with no external reinforcement. It filled her entire life space. But where was the aura of love's bliss? Now, Thelma wasn't in love. Not that love and suffering don't go together. In my experience, they often do. But Thelma's love is monstrously out of balance. There's no pleasure in it at all. Her life is completely tormented. I still want to help her, and I think I can. It won't be easy. She's held on to this for so long. First of all, she'll have to agree to give up her infatuation. During our next session, when I explain this to Thelma, I get the feeling she's not listening. She's switched herself off, as if it's someone else's problem we're discussing. And then, just when I start to think I'm finally getting somewhere, she begins the familiar eulogy of Matthew's finer points.
You see, Matthew has a gentleness about him that touches the life of everyone who comes in contact with him. The secretaries all loved him. He knew all their children's names. He brought in donuts for them 3 or 4 mornings a week. Whenever we went out, he always found something to say that would make the waiter or the store clerk feel good. Do you know anything about Buddhist meditation practice?
Well, yes. As a matter of fact, I spent about 6
then
years...
You know about loving-kindness meditation? He did that twice a day and taught me how to do it, too. That's why I would never dream... Not in 100 years that he would treat me like this. His silence is killing me. He couldn't have picked a worse punishment.
But why do you give Matthew so much power? He's just another human being, like you or me. He struggles like you or me. He'll get older. His skin will wrinkle. His hair will go gray. He'll die.
You... don't believe me, do you? You want to make our 27 days into nothing. You can't understand something so beautiful. I wish I'd never told you about him.
Well, you did. And I don't understand why you've never told anyone before.
It's obvious, isn't it?
No.
I made a promise.
What promise? Who did you promise?
I mean, I never actually promised Matthew out loud. I just promised myself that I would protect him, just in case.
No, I don't understand. In case of what?
In case we got back together, of course.
Thelma, I really think
there's still a chance, you know. As long as he and I are on the same planet, there's a chance.
Thelma, I still don't get it. Why, in 8 years of therapy, did you never tell anyone about Matthew?
Haven't you guessed why? And here was I, thinking you were really good. Matthew was my therapist.
If I could employ a little magic that would finally destroy this dream that pains me and enchains me, but I can't.
I never liked the sound of Matthew, but now I'm furious. Why did he do it? Why violate the sacred code of any helping profession? Okay, it happens. But it's always damaging to the patient. I decide to track down Matthew and invite him to the office. Getting Matthew here might be the key to understanding what's happening. Let's ask Matthew what he feels. And to my surprise, he agrees to come. When Matthew enters the room, it's the first time he's seen Thelma in 8 years. I'm watching him like a hawk. And if he's in any way startled by the physical aging she's undergone, his boyish, good-natured smile gives no sign of it. He's older than I expect, perhaps in his early 40s, and conservatively dressed in an un-Californian 3-piece suit. Otherwise, he's just as Thelma had described him, slender, mustached, well-tanned.
Thank you so much for inviting me. I've been wanting, well, hoping for something like this for years. Besides, I've read all your books, did Thelma say? It's an honor to meet you.
I have to admit, he's charming.
I'm here today to be helpful to Thelma.
Thelma, meanwhile, is sitting with a big grin on her face. She looks 10 years younger. She's had her hair done, she's wearing lipstick and an attractive royal blue dress and stockings instead of her usual polyester jogging suit. The blue dress is quite a daring outfit for a 70-year-old.
I know she's been going through bad times, and I know I bear the responsibility for that. I want to answer your questions, if I can.
This is Thelma's perfect cue. She leans forward in her chair.
My mouth feels so dry, I can hardly talk. Is that the antidepressants, do you think?
Thelma continued to ramble and consume huge chunks of our precious time. But too much was riding on this hour. This was her chance to ask the questions that had plagued her for years. This was her chance to be released.
My head is aching. I'm dizzy. I feel nauseous.
Thelma, I'm going to interrupt you for a minute. I think you have some questions for Matthew.
Yes. Yes. I guess the bottom line is...
She turned carefully to Matthew.
What do you feel about me?
I think about you all the time. I want to know what happens to you. I wish that there was some way that we could meet up, you know, once in a while. I hate feeling so cut off from you.
Then why have you been silent all these years?
Sometimes caring can be best expressed by silence.
Oh, that's like one of your Zen riddles that I never could understand.
Whenever I tried to talk to you, it made things worse. It all got out of hand. That day we met up in Union Square, I knew you were lonely. You wanted to talk, spend some time. I was happy to do that. I wanted you to be happy, Thelma. You know all this. I've gone through it many times before.
Matthew turned to me and didn't look at Thelma until he'd finished his story.
You see, I had a breakdown. I was still in a very fragmented state of mind. The day after I came out of hospital, I was glad. I was very glad to run into Thelma. I was happy to see a familiar face. And she seemed very pleased to see me.
Matthew!
I nearly didn't recognize you there. How are you?
Oh, I'm fine. Oh, it's really good to see you.
She seemed to need me, and it helped me feel anchored again. I had just become a Buddhist at the time. I was practicing loving-kindness meditation. So I decided to give her everything she needed. She wanted me to be close to her. She wanted to come home with me. She wanted to stay the night. She wanted me to hold her in my arms. So I tried to do whatever she asked. It made me feel good. For the first time in months, I felt good about myself.
Till the stars were strong.
Tell me I'm beautiful.
Of course you are.
Tell me you want me.
You know I do.
I love you, Matthew. Say you love me.
Of course. I'll say whatever you want me to. But after that night, she wants more. More and more. She wants to see me the next day and the day after that. She keeps calling and calling 20, 30 times a day. She leaves so many messages. She jams the machine. We just spent one night. Now this goes on for 27 days. I can't keep up with how much she wants of me. 27 days. I couldn't cope. It was impossible. I couldn't give any more. After 3 or 4 weeks, it got so bad for me that I am readmitted to the hospital, this time for 6 weeks. Then, I haven't been out long, when I get Thelma's new message. She tells me she's tried to kill herself. I feel awful. It's the worst thing that could have happened. So, in the end, I decide to break off all contact. I mean, it's the only way for both of us. I know there are people who have affairs with their patients, therapists who, you know, abuse their position of privilege. But I wasn't like that. I mean, I hate that. It had never, ever happened to me before. And I gave up being a therapist in the end. I just felt so bad about the whole thing. I cared for Thelma very much, but I just couldn't cope with how much she wanted from me.
Tears poured down Thelma's new blue dress until Matthew, who just beat me to it, handed her the box of tissues. Was it possible that she knew all this from the start and had deliberately concealed it from me? Or was she so absorbed in her own distress and her own needs that she had been completely unaware of Matthew's mental state? I looked at her, but she averted her glance. We'd run 20 minutes over and had to stop, even though Thelma hadn't exactly regained her composure. The three of us ended the session with round-robin handshakes and parted. Thelma had not recovered by the next day. She'd worked and worried Matthew's statement that he cared for her until it seemed an insult. It was time to pull out this obsession once and for all.
I feel like someone's cut off my right arm. When you were a kid, did you ever come outside after the circus and think how gray life was? How ordinary? How endlessly dull?
Thelma, this is your chance to start again. This is what you wanted. We're nearly there.
Until yesterday, I had a chance. A small chance, I know. But I could still hope that Matthew and I could go back to that time. As long as we were alive, we always had a chance. Until yesterday in your office, I could live with a 1% chance like that. The feeling was real. I know love when I feel it. You want to know how I feel now? I feel old. For the first time in my life, I'm 70. 70. I'm dried up. Done. And I've wasted 8 years of my life protecting Matthew. 8 years! And what reward did I get? I'll tell you what I got. A kick in the teeth.
I don't understand. That's not how I saw it.
You were there? He didn't even say goodbye to me. He didn't answer my questions. He still hasn't told me why he finished it off.
But I found Matthew very warm towards you. He went into lengthy and painful detail about why he'd broken off with you.
And you believed all that?
Clearly, there were still quite a few threads of illusion to be severed. I'd almost destroyed the obsession. Now it was time to finish the job. Time for me to play love's executioner.
Thelma, what I have to say now is not easy, but let me try to say it clearly. If two people share a moment, or share a feeling, if they both feel the same thing, then I can see how it might be possible for them, as long as they're alive, to reestablish that precious feeling. Now, it would be a delicate thing. After all, people change, And, you know, love never stays still. But I have to admit, it might be possible. But suppose it never was a shared experience. I mean, suppose the two people had widely different experiences. And suppose one of them mistakenly thought her experience was the same as his.
No.
What I heard in the session with Matthew was just that. His experience and your experience were very different. He was in one place, you were in another. He was lost, Thelma. He said it himself. He wanted you to be happy. But he wasn't having a loving experience because he didn't know who he was. The 27 days of paradise didn't exist for him.
No, I won't accept that.
You were looking for love, for your youth, to mean something.
No.
But you can't recreate a state of shared romantic love with Matthew because it was never there in the first place.
No, I won't listen to this. I used to spend 90% of my time thinking about Matthew. If I don't do that, there's nothing left.
Thelma. Thelma.
I never saw Thelma again. I called her once to see if she'd changed her mind, but she hadn't. Her losses, she said, had been too great. She'd lost the best 27 days of her life. She'd lost her hope for the future. She'd even lost her 8 years of sacrifice. I was sorry. Thelma chose not to be cured. She decided to cling to the tiniest chance that she might one day revive her relationship with her lover, rather than face the reality of never having it again. And I'm left with the question, what did I want? Did I want to be the one to unpick that obsession once and for all? Did I want to understand it so much that I failed to listen to all the warning signs? Was I kidding myself? I had fallen prey to the grandiose belief that I could cure anyone. So, now what do I want? You know what I want? I want to go home and sit in my garden. I want to chat with my wife and watch my kids while the dusk around me finally starts to fall.
Now you say you're sorry for being so untrue. Well, you can cry me a river, cry me a river. I cried a river.